Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Today I would like to talk about ferroelectric phase transitions in strained potassium sodium niobate epitaxial films studied by in situ X-ray diffraction and three-dimensional phase field simulation. So this is actually a collaboration between our group at the Leibniz Institute für Kristallzüchtung in Berlin, Germany, and a theory group from the Pennsylvania State University who have performed the three-dimensional phase field simulations. Let me first start with the material system potassium sodium niobate. It's a lead-free perovskite-like material with promising ferro and piezoelectric properties already as bulk material. It exhibits high Curie temperatures but has been hardly studied as film material so far because of the high volatility of the sodium and potassium, which may lead to defects and high leakage current. In order to overcome this problem, we have performed metal organic vapor phase epitaxy, MOVPE, which is carried out at high partial oxygen pressure close to thermodynamical equilibrium at typical growth temperatures around 700 degrees centigrade. And this highly sophisticated growth techniques leads to very perfect, coherently strained, stoichiometric films with a very regular ferroelectric domain pattern. And as a typical example, I show on the right side a lateral piezo response force micrograph of a 30 nanometer thin film grown on neodym scandate substrate, and you see here a very regular herringbone domain pattern, and this high periodicity is a direct proof of the high perfectness of the thin film. So we are interested in phases and phase transitions in our thin films. For bulk crystals, the parameter for phase transitions or for phases is the temperature. However, for thin films, it's not only the temperature, it's also the epitaxial misfit strain incorporated in the thin film. And in the middle of this transparency, the so-called temperature misfit strain phase diagram is shown, where depending on temperature and strain, different ferroelectric phases may appear. For example, close to room temperature, we see a mixture of the monoclinic MC phase and the monoclinic A1, A2 phase. And it would be nice to experimentally prove the existence of these monoclinic phases, in particular to prove the existence of this mixed regime at room temperature. And the other question is, can we identify and study a phase transition at high temperature, and how does this mixed regime change at high temperatures? Okay, so at this slide, I will first start at room temperature. You see here at the left side experimental evidence or experimental proof of this mixture. We indeed find a model where we have a coexistence of MC monoclinic phases and A1 monoclinic phase. So the MC phase is shown on the left side top. You see the unit cell where we have this shearing, and the polarization vector lies within this plane of the unit cell and is inclined. On the other hand, when you turn this unit cell by 90 degrees such that the polarization vector lies now in plane, we end up with the A1, A2 phase. And you see now that the herringbone pattern is composed of a regular arrangement of these MC and A1, A2 phases. And you see this already also at the right side with the lateral piezo response force micrograph. And the very nice thing is now that when you perform three-dimensional phase field simulations, you end up exactly with the same model. You also here see the herringbone pattern consisting of MC phases, which are shown on the bottom with green color, and the A1, A2 phases shown in the bottom as pink and violet colors. So we have a very, very nice agreement between theory and experiment. So what will happen now at high temperatures? So when we heat up the sample and look, let's heat up the sample and look at the PFM images. First, I have to say, when you measuring PFM at high temperatures, you have to use a rather robust cantilever, somehow reducing the experimental spatial resolution. So when you look at the left side, you do not see the herringbone pattern as good resolved as I have shown you already before, but this is the herringbone pattern we see here. So when we heat up to 180 degrees C, nothing has changed. Of course, we see some thermal drift, but when you further heat, let's say up to 250 degrees centigrade, you see an abrupt change of the domain pattern. So you see here a stripe domain pattern. So we really observe here a ferro-to-ferroelectric phase transitions within the temperature range of between 180 degrees C and 250 degrees C. However, as you know, PFM does not give you any information about phase symmetry. In order to get this information, we have performed three-dimensional in situ X-ray diffraction. So why three-dimensional? Because on one hand side, the strains themselves are three-dimensional in their nature. We have in-plane strains, we have out-of-plane strains, we have shearing in different directions. So this is all 3D. On the other hand, the domain morphology, so the arrangement of the domain walls, is also 3D. Therefore, we have to measure the intensity distribution in reciprocal space in all three dimensions. In order to do this in a rapid way, we have used a 2D detector, and then it goes so fast that we can even do in situ investigations because one 3D reciprocal space map does not take too much time. Of course, for these studies, we need a very intense X-ray source, so we have to do all these experiments at synchrotron radiation facilities. And at the bottom you see two experiments, exemplarily one at BESSI-2 at the left side and one at the IO7 beamline at the Diamond Light source in UK. And you can distinguish, you can do now really true 3D out-of-plane coplanar X-ray diffraction, but you can also concentrate on grazing incidents in plane X-ray diffraction, where we have only investigated this in two dimensions. And the first example is now when you measure now the diffraction pattern at different temperatures. At room temperature, you see a typical fingerprint of the herringbone pattern. You see the peaks P1, P2, which arise from the A1, A2 phase. And you see the peak P3, which arises from the monoclinic MC phase. And when you heat up the samples to high temperature, we see a change in the diffraction pattern, indicating that we have a structural phase transitions at these high temperatures. When you further heat up the sample, you see you end up with the paraelectric phase at about 500 degrees centigrade. So in order to investigate now the crystal symmetry at these high temperatures, we have to measure a set of different brachiofractions because we have to disentangle different features in this diffraction pattern. One is, for example, the peak splitting caused by the phase symmetry, P1, P2, P3, for example. The other hand is we have strong satellite peaks caused by the very perfect domain periodicity. And for that reason, we have to and in order to get information, we have to set up a model in real space. And in this case, we have set up four different orthorhombic unit cells, which are slightly rotated in different orientations, ending up in four different variants of A1, A2 stripe domain patterns. And when we put this model into numerical X-ray simulations, we end up here at the left side, at the to the bottom, we see these four simulations, and they fit quite nicely to the experimentally observed diffraction pattern. So indeed, we have at high temperature a slightly rotated orthorhombic phase. Okay, we can compare this also now with phase field simulations. And on the right-hand side, we see that also in the three-dimensional phase field simulations, we observe orthorhombic phase with A1 and A2 unit cells. And we observe, by the way, also different stripe domain variants, quite similar to the variants we observe in the PFM image in the middle. So we have a very good or an overall good agreement between simulations and experimental data. So far I have shown you only experiments performed in 2D, so in plane. So, but what is now the 3D domain wall arrangement? For that reason, we have performed true three-dimensional X-ray diffraction in order to determine the 3D arrangement. So you see here on the left side a 3D diffraction pattern, which took only 30 minutes. And we see here four prominent streaks coming from the domain wall. So we have four different domain walls. And in order to make it more clear, I have made now in-plane and out-of-plane sections at the right side of the transparency. And you can directly compare this now to three-dimensional phase field simulations. And they perfectly fit. So for example, the in-plane herringbone angle xi is reproduced. It gives us 20 degrees, also in the phase field simulations. But more importantly, also out of plane, you see domain wall angles of plus minus 45 degrees in the experiment. And this is also exactly reproduced in the phase field simulation. So again, a very, very nice agreement. You can do the same thing now for the high temperature phase. We again see a very rich diffraction pattern, and you can do again in-plane and out-of-plane sections. In the in-plane section, you see a crossed-like behavior, and this cross comes from the stripe domain pattern, which are oriented 90 degrees to each other, so the angle xi is plus minus 45 degrees. More importantly, when you look at the out-of-plane section, you see the intensity distribution, which is aligned in the horizontal direction, proving that the domain walls are oriented vertically to the sample surface, and this is exactly what you observe in the phase field simulation shown below. So again, a very, very good agreement between theory and experiment. So, but how exactly does now the phase transition take place? And for that reason, I've shown you now a true temperature series between room temperature and about 260 degrees centigrade. On top you see the phase field simulation, and the bottom you see the corresponding X-ray data. And we start at the top left, you see the simulated domain pattern with the A1, A2 and MC domains. This is reproduced in the X-ray data. You see the peaks P1, P2 coming from the A1, A2 domains, and you see the peak P3 originating from the MC domains. When you heat up the sample a little bit, nothing seriously will happen, but when you go to the middle of this X-ray data at 180 degrees C, you see that only the peaks P1, P2 are preserved while P3 has vanished. So the MC phase has vanished, and this is exactly what we observe in the simulation. You see here at 227 degrees in the simulation that only the A1, A2 domains survived and MC has vanished. When you go one step further at 220 degrees centigrade, you see a phase coexistence now. First in the simulation, you see the A1, A2, and on top you see the beginning of the orthorhombic A1/A2 phase. And this is exactly what we observe also in the X-ray data. We still see the splitting P1, P2, but we see also this diagonal streak coming from the orthorhombic A1/A2 phase. So we have here phase consistence between both. And when you further heat up, you will see in the simulation that the A1, A2 phase is also vanishing, and we have solely A1/A2, and this is exactly what we observe in the X-ray data. We have, do not observe any more P1 and P2, so we have pure the orthorhombic phase. Okay, so we have phase consistent, coexistence, indicating that it's a first order type phase transition. We can also prove this, further prove this, by measuring a thermal hysteresis, and this is exactly what we observe when we look at the intensity in this, within this wide rectangular region here in the experimental data, and evaluate now this intensity as a function of temperature. And depending on whether we are heating and cooling, we see here at the bottom left, we see really a thermal hysteresis of about 20 Kelvin between heating and cooling, again, supporting that we have a first order phase transition. So let me summarize. I hope I have convinced you that the combined use of 3D in situ X-ray diffraction and 3D phase field simulation is a powerful tool to structurally investigate nanometer-sized ferroelectric domains and to identify and understand phase transitions. And with my final acknowledgement, transparency, I would like to thank you for your attention.